Nowadays, outer space is a given in everyone's mind. It's virtually in every movie, video game, comic book, novel, and even music and TV shows, causing mostly everyone to believe in outer space without question, even though they have never been there or seen it for themselves. Did you know that we are told that a mere 536 people have been to space, with only 24 of them traveling beyond low Earth orbit? That's barely a drop in the bucket as far as the entirety of Earth's population is concerned. And one of the funniest things is that all 24 people that have supposedly been past low Earth orbit come from the Apollo missions that took place between 1963 and 1972. We haven't been able to go that far since. Here's a glimpse of what NASA astronauts of today are saying.
Right now, we only can fly in Earth orbit. That's the farthest that we can go.
The kinds of technologies that we're testing out on space station are definitely helping us with our goals of going beyond low Earth orbit.
Early in the next decade, a set of crewed flights will test and prove the systems required for exploration beyond low Earth orbit.
And this is really the beginning, I think, of human beings leaving low Earth orbit.
And here's Apollo 12 astronaut Alan Bean being interviewed about the Van Allen radiation belts.
Any ill effects from the Van Allen radiation belts?
No, now I'm not sure we went far enough out to encounter the Van Allen radiation belt. Maybe we did. I don't know the distance to the Van Allen radiation belt.
The belts are 1,000 miles to 25,000 miles above the Earth.
We went right out through them.
No effects on yourselves?
Didn't even know it. I don't think anybody, well, maybe somebody said you went through the radiation belt, but we didn't feel it inside, and we didn't get any, you know, added radiation. Not on our mission, by the way, they hadn't been discovered yet.
So you see, he wasn't even sure what the Van Allen belts were, and when he was told, he basically says that the radiation belts didn't apply to his mission because they hadn't been discovered yet. Fun fact, did you know that all the data having to do with the alleged moon landings was lost and no longer exists?
I'd go to the moon in a nanosecond. The problem is we don't have the technology to do that anymore. We used to, but we destroyed that technology, and it's a painful process to build it back again.
I haven't seen anything that indicates the telemetry data is even in existence, and as I said, even if we had it, we don't have the machines to play it back.
Unfortunately, I'm afraid I can't really give you much of a clue as to where this data ended up and whether it still exists or not.
How anyone can trust NASA is beyond me. Now let's talk about how we got here, to the point where space is an unquestionable fact. Let's start with how the geocentric flat Earth model dominated from the beginning of recorded history all the way up into the 1600s, and though it's mostly propaganda, even the Flat Earth Wikipedia contains a bit of truth. Many ancient cultures subscribed to a flat Earth cosmography, including China, until the 17th century. Now let's look at an article I found that supports this. The ancient Chinese accepted the Earth being a flat geocentric, and that an umbrella-like covering surrounded it, which was similar to the beliefs of the Greek, East Indian, Egyptians, Norse, and Germanic, as well as the Aboriginal people of the Americas. The Chinese astronomers believed that heaven takes its body from the yang, so it is round and in motion, and that the Earth takes its body from the yin, so it is flat and quiescent. The brilliant astronomers of China held this unchanging belief until the Jesuit missionaries came to China in the 17th century. Alberto Rivera, a former Jesuit priest, claimed the goal of the Jesuit order was to create a one-world religion by influencing all institutions of thought. Their goal, I believe, is not to make everyone belong to just one church, but for all churches to adhere to their cosmology and thought form. By taking over the sciences, they can cut out any greater divine beliefs in the creation of Earth. The most interesting thing about that is the Jesuit order was founded in 1540, during a time when the Earth was still depicted like this. Earth in the center, with the wandering stars moving around us, surrounded by the firmament, just like all ancient cultures. And 100 years later, this is what was being pumped out. By the Jesuits, of course. After the Jesuit order was established is when the heliocentric programming began. In 1634, a book called Somnium, Latin for the dream, was published. Written by Johannes Kepler, an obvious Freemason, this is the first ever novel to talk about traveling to the moon. The story is about an Icelandic voyager who is transported to the moon by aerial demons, followed by another book called The Man in the Moon, written in 1638 by Francis Godwin. A Spaniard flies to the moon using a contraption pulled by geese. Followed by The Discovery of a World in the Moon, written in 1638 by John Wilkins. This book helped to popularize the new science of astronomy in England, based in particular on Johannes Kepler's Somnium and Galileo's discoveries with the telescope. This is particularly interesting because modern refracting telescopes are based on a design proposed by Johannes Kepler, and the Jesuit Brotherhood is directly responsible for first spreading the said telescope technology in the 17th century. And the list goes on as far as books dedicated to a trip to the moon. Well into the 1900s, where in 1902, one of the first movies ever made in the world was called A Trip to the Moon. From there, the programming got increasingly faster with each decade until it became yearly and even weekly and then daily. Science fiction comics exploded in the 1930s. We went to the moon thousands of times in these books and movies long before NASA was even brought into the picture. Walt Disney made a space propaganda film in 1955, just 3 years before the founding of NASA.
Here to introduce you to this new series is Walt Disney.
In our modern world, everywhere we look, we see the influence science has upon our daily lives. Discoveries that were miracles a few short years ago are accepted as commonplace today. Many of the things that seem impossible now will become realities tomorrow.
One of man's oldest dreams has been the desire for space travel, to travel to other worlds. Until recently, this seemed to be an impossibility, but great new discoveries have brought us to the threshold of a new frontier. The frontier of interplanetary space.
The same year NASA was founded, in 1958, the Jet Propulsion Lab, or JPL, Jack Parsons Lab, was transferred to NASA by the U.S. Army. The Jet Propulsion Laboratory was founded by Jack Parsons. Jack Parsons was a member of the OTO, the Ordo Templi Orientis, and he was heavily influenced by Aleister Crowley. He was also deeply connected to Ron L. Hubbard, the founder of the Church of Scientology. And it all goes so much deeper, the rabbit hole never seems to end. So finally, they fake going to the moon for the first time in 1969, and they do it five more times by 1972. Now everybody believes that outer space is 100% real and that traversing the stars is a possibility. The movies keep coming. The TV shows. The
bang.
The video games. The music videos.
Ground control to Major Tom.
Rocket Man, burning out his fuse out there at home.
Tonight. Mars Lander, what's happening up there?
Here we are today. We haven't faked going into deep space in almost 50 years. We just continue to believe in it simply because that is what we're seeing on that screen. I go to the movie theater sometimes, and every single time I go, this ad for the movie theater plays before the movie. Check this out.
Thanks for coming with me tonight.
Yeah, no, I love robots.
So, what's your favorite movie?
In space.
In space. With zombies.
You get two Cokes and a popcorn.
So, what's your favorite movie?
In space.
In space. With zombies. You get...
In space. With zombies. Yeah, you got that right. Outer space is for zombies. Once you see all of this for what it is, and that the joke is on us, it's just absolutely ridiculous what they have us blindly believing. Fun fact, the term outer space wasn't recorded until 1875. This has been ODD. Much love, everybody. Stay flat.
Stay flat. Stay flat. Stay flat. Stay flat.
Stay flat. Wake up, you need the money. Used to play pretend, used to play pretend, bunny. We used to play pretend, wake up, you need the money. Used to play pretend, give each other different names. We would build a rocket ship and then we fly far away. Used to dream of outer space, but now they're laughing at the face, saying, wake up, you need to make money. Yeah.